Good morning, dear students. So this is your third online perio theory class. The topic today is bone loss and patterns of bone destruction. Okay, so before I tell you more about it, there is one concept that has to be clear in your head. Okay, and that is periodontitis is always preceded by gingivitis, but not all gingivitis progress to periodontitis. Okay, so I want you to understand this properly. Periodontitis is always preceded by gingivitis. It means that from health condition to gingivitis, and then further from gingivitis, or the case, if there is more microflora, if the host is compromised or any other reason, it progresses to periodontitis. Okay, so periodontitis is always preceded by gingivitis, but not all case of gingivitis progress to periodontitis. In so many cases, it will remain as gingivitis lifelong. Okay, while in some other cases, this gingivitis may progress to periodontitis on a later date. Okay, so periodontitis is always preceded by gingivitis, but not all gingivitis progress to periodontitis. Okay, so that basic concept has to be clear to you. The next is pathway of inflammation from gingiva to supporting structures. Okay, so most of the time what happens is the inflammation or the microbial accumulation usually starts in your interdental papillae or in the interdental area. Okay, so from the interdental area, this disease or this inflammation progresses first to your alveolar bone almost always. And then from the alveolar bone, it goes to your PDL or cementum of the adjacent teeth. Okay, just in case you have not understood this concept very clearly, the diagram is there in the PPT, so you can see that and understand it better. The progress of inflammation from the interdental area will be into your alveolar bone, and then from your alveolar bone into the PDL and cementum. Okay. So that happens in the interdental area, whereas in the facial and the lingual areas, it first inflammation first starts and then it goes over to the periosteum or the outer part of the alveolar bone, and then it progresses further to your PDL. Very, very rarely the inflammation directly goes into the periodontal ligament space. Okay, so that is your pathway of inflammation from gingiva to the supporting structures. Okay, now the next important point to understand is radius of action. Now, radius of action means that if a microorganism is present, then there is a certain limit or there is a certain radius up to which it can exert its action. Okay, so if a microorganism is present here, then up to 1.5 to 2.5 mm radius, it can exert its action. Okay, which means if your host cell is present at 4 mm distance from the microorganism, can the microorganism affect your host cell? No. Okay, so if the microorganism has to affect any cell, it has to be between 1.5 to 2.5 mm radius. Okay, so that is radius of action. The next important thing is rate of bone loss. The rate at which there will be bone loss will not be the same for everybody. Okay, so there is this very, very important study which was conducted by Low et al. On Sri Lankan tea workers. Okay, and he found that Sri Lankan tea workers are people who at that point of time did not practice any plaque control measures. Okay, there was no plaque control measures at all. So then he followed them up over a period of years and he found out that 8% of people had rapid progression of alveolar bone loss and attachment loss of up to 0.1 to 1 mm. Okay, 8% people. 81% had moderately progressive disease with a yearly loss of maximum up to 0.5 mm. Whereas 11% people had minimum bone loss, which means less than 0.05 mm per year. Okay, so is the Low et al. Study clear to you? It states that the rate of bone loss is different for different people. He had conducted a study on Sri Lankan tea workers and he found that for 8% people, there was rapid disease progression. 81% had moderate progression and 11% had minimal or no progression. So that was regarding the rate of bone loss. Next is regarding the periods of destruction. I think it is for your batch that I had taken periodontal pockets, and I had told you about the example that my HOD had told me. Okay, so if you remember that, the same concept applies here. It means that for some time the disease will be in the active stage and there will be bone loss. After that, there will be a period of inactivity. And then further, there will be again a period of bone loss. Okay, I think it is to your batch that I told you this example. So if you remember, tell in the comment section below what exactly that example was. Okay. Next is mechanism of bone destruction. Mechanism of bone destruction is another very, very important topic. Okay. There is this diagram by Conman. It's there in the PPT. Okay. So what does that diagram state? First, there is bacteria on the teeth. These bacteria will release antigens and other deleterious substances which will go and affect the host. And the host in turn will release antibodies and other defense cells. But eventually, if the host is not able to combat against these bacteria, then it will cause connective tissue and bone destruction, and eventually there will be clinical signs of disease and progression of bone loss. And there are many factors like genetic factors, environment factors, risk factors, all these can affect this chart. Okay, so that was regarding the mechanism of bone destruction. So I hope till here everything is clear to you. Okay, so the next heading is factors determining bone morphology in periodontal disease. Okay, in this, one type is exostosis, which means bulbous bony protuberances that are seen in the alveolar bone. Okay, so that is exostosis. It's best understood with the help of the diagram. The diagram is there in the PPT. Then next is trauma from occlusion. Trauma from occlusion is a chapter in itself, but basically it means that if your bite is traumatic and there's excess load on the opposite tooth, okay, then what happens is a particular type of bone loss pattern appears, which is in the crestal area, funnel shaped bone loss occurs. Okay, so that is a type of bone loss pattern which is seen in trauma from occlusion. Next is buttressing bone formation. What does buttressing bone formation mean? All our bone cells, like how much ever destruction you cause, they always try to, you know, come back, try to again form whatever is lost. But what is being formed in this period of repair might not be something as good as what was originally there. Okay, I hope you get my point. So that is buttressing bone formation. So the bone that is formed by buttressing bone formation is not as strong as the bone that was already present there before the disease. Okay, so that is buttressing bone formation. Next is food impaction. If there is plaque accumulation in a particular area, then there is food impaction in a particular, because of food impaction, then there is more chance of bone destruction there. Okay, next is aggressive periodontitis. It is another type of periodontal disease, okay, in which mostly you will see that it affects the first molars and the incisors. So there is arc-shaped bone loss which is seen with respect to the first molars if it is a localized pattern of aggressive periodontitis. Okay, so the next most important part of this chapter is bone destruction patterns in periodontal defect. Okay, so what does this mean? If the destruction around the tooth, okay, is such that it is the same on either side. If this is the tooth, the level of destruction is same on either side, okay, and it is same with respect to the other tooth also. Okay, so that is horizontal type of bone loss. Okay, and the diagram is there. You can see the diagram and understand it better. Next is vertical type of bone loss, which means the bone loss around, if these are two teeth, then the bone loss around this teeth is more compared to the bone loss around this teeth, and hence an angular defect is formed. Okay, so this would be an example of a angular defect. Okay, if this is one tooth and this is another tooth root, and the bone loss is more extensive for this tooth, for this root compared to this one, then this is angular type of bone loss. In angular type of bone loss, one very important concept which is difficult to understand is classification of angular bone loss. Okay, so I have just taken this to show you as an example. I don't know how much you can understand in it. For example, if this portion is your tooth root, okay, and this is the alveolar bone on the side, and then there is another tooth here, okay, and then the another tooth also has alveolar bone around it, okay, for example. So now if this is one tooth, okay, 1 minute, this is one tooth and this was the bone around it, then ideally there would be four walls to this bone, okay. This would be the first wall, this would be the second wall, this would be the third wall, this would be the fourth wall, okay. So there are four walls on one side of the tooth, okay. For example, if one wall is missing, then what does it become? There are three walls and on one side there is a defect, okay. So this becomes your three wall defect. There are three walls and one wall is defective, one wall is not there, okay. And but this is your tooth, okay. So this occlusally, if you see, you will see that there are three walls that are present, but the wall that was here is missing. So this is a three wall defect, okay. Now for example, if this is a situation, okay. So what is this situation? Two walls of the tooth are missing. This wall is also missing and this wall is also missing. So two walls are present and two walls are absent. So this is a two wall defect, okay. Now I'll show you another example in which now what do you see? You will see that three walls are missing. This wall is missing, this wall is missing, this wall is also missing. So this is a one wall defect. So there is one wall that is present and three defective, or three walls which are missing, okay. So this is a one wall defect. Now I want you to tell me in the comment section below, of whatever you have understood, which is the best type of bone loss pattern compared to the three wall, two wall and one wall defect, okay. Which is the best one? Tell me in the comment section, okay. Now next pattern of bone loss is osseous crater, which means that on both sides the facial and the lingual bony plates are intact, but the interdental bone is lost such that it is scooped in this area, okay. So that becomes your osseous crater. The diagram is there in the PPT. Next is reverse architecture. Also you have to see the diagram to understand. It means that, see, ideally what happens, the level of interradicular bone will be more apical to the interdental bone, okay. So you will be having like this: interdental bone is high, interradicular bone is low, and then interdental bone is high, then interradicular bone is low. So that's what happens usually, okay. In reverse architecture, it means that the interdental bone is more apical compared to the interradicular bone, okay. So the architecture gets reversed, better understood in the diagram, okay. So and then there are ledges are basically plateau type of bone defect patterns that are seen. It is better understood in the diagram again. So I want you to go through the PPT, go through all the images in the PPT, and if any doubts, please do ask in the comment section. Also do let me know if this class was helpful for you, okay. Okay, so I'll once again revise the entire class again. Bone loss and patterns of destruction. One important concept to be understood is periodontitis is always preceded by gingivitis, but not all cases of gingivitis progress to periodontal disease. Okay, pathway of inflammation spread from the gingiva to the supporting structures. In the interdental area, it will first affect the alveolar bone and from there it will go and affect the PDL. Very rarely will the infection directly spread into the PDL space. Similarly, in the facial and the lingual plate, almost always the inflammation progresses first towards the periosteum, which is the outer part of the alveolar bone, and only then it goes into the PDL space. Very rarely will the infection directly enter into your PDL space. Then there is a radius of action, which is 1.5 to 2.5 mm. There is rate of bone loss based on a study conducted by Lu et al. On Sri Lankan tea workers. He gave three categories: 8% rapid destruction, 81% moderate destruction, 11% minimal or no progression of destruction. Then there is periods of destruction, which is bone loss pattern happens in periods of activity followed by periods of inactivity. Then there is mechanism of bone destruction, the pattern that is there in the PPT. There is this diagram, which is very important. You can draw it in so many places actually. I'll tell you the details regarding that later. I don't want to deviate. And the next is factors determining bone morphology in periodontal disease: normal variations in alveolar bone, exostosis, trauma from occlusion, buttressing bone formation, foot impaction, aggressive periodontitis. Next, coming to the bone destruction patterns in periodontal disease, there is horizontal bone loss. If two teeth are there and the level of bone is same around both of them, then it is horizontal bone loss. If the level of bone is more apical compared to the adjacent tooth, then it becomes vertical bone loss. In vertical bone loss, there is one wall, two wall, three wall defect, which is really very important. Now, this is if this is the tooth and this is the bone around it, and if all the four walls are present, 1, 2, 3, 4, okay, then it is intact. If one wall is missing, it is a three wall defect. If two walls are missing, then it's a two wall defect, and if only one wall is present, then it is a one wall defect. The three wall defect is best because in case you want to do any regenerative procedures, you can place bone graft here. Okay, so three walls are there present so that it can hold the remaining bone graft material. Then coming to the next, which is osseous craters, in which facial and lingual facial and lingual plates are intact. There is interdental bone loss. Then there is bulbous bony contour, reverse architecture. Interradicular bone is present more coronally compared to the interdental bone. Then there is ledges, which is plateau shaped bone loss. Okay, so I hope this class was useful for you. I've revised everything again. Any doubts, please do ask. Also, please do tell me your comments and feedbacks. Thank you. Have a good day.